Hello and welcome to another Sussex Universe talk. For this talk I'll be talking about black holes and the hot spaghettification of cool doughnuts. I'm Dr. Darren Baskill. I'm an astronomer and lecturer in the Department of Physics and Astronomy at the University of Sussex in Brighton. But for this talk I'm talking about black holes, so we need to begin by, well, finding out where black holes begin. And black holes are the natural endpoints of massive stars. So let me talk to you about how stars evolve. Stars are formed from massive gas clouds. And that gas is pulled together under gravity, gravity literally squeezing stars into existence. And that's how they form. And that includes our sun as well. Now, our sun is a very average star, average size, average colour, average temperature. And at the moment, it's a main sequence star. It will be a main sequence star for about 10 billion years. And like me, the sun is in middle age. So it's been around for about 5 billion years. And it'll be around for another 5 billion years as well. Then when the sun approaches the end of its life, it will expand over a few hundred million years to become a red giant star, and then eventually the outer layers of the sun will blow out into space, and all that's left behind is a white dwarf star. And we see every step of this in various locations in our galaxy. And planetary nebula are really beautiful objects to look at through even a small telescope. So that's what will happen to our sun. It will evolve and become a planetary nebula, losing all the outer layers, and all that's left behind will be a white dwarf, less than the mass of the sun and about the size of the Earth. So white dwarf stars are the core of the original star. Now, more massive stars evolve a bit differently. It starts again with a massive gas cloud, but in this case more gas clumps together and so it forms a bigger star. But that star lives on the main sequence not quite for so long as the sun will, a billion years at most. And then it evolves into a red supergiant star, so it's a much bigger star. Now when that comes to the end of its life, when it runs out of fuel, supergiant stars die in spectacular fashion and they explode as a supernova, the center of the star collapses inwards and a shockwave drives out the outer layers into space. Then what's left behind is either a neutron star, if less than about two solar masses, or if they have more than two solar masses worth of stuff left behind, then it will collapse to form a black hole. So white dwarf stars, neutron stars and black holes, they are all the endpoints of stellar evolution. The only difference being that black holes are so massive, they get incredibly dense and so dense that nothing, not even light, can escape a black hole. So that's our starting point. We know of three different types of black holes. Basically, small, medium, and large. Small black holes we call stellar black holes, and we see them all over our galaxy, our city of stars in which we live. And these stellar black holes, we see them in binary systems, so in pairs of stars, where one is a black hole and it's usually feeding and dragging gas from its companion, and that's how we spot them. You can also get intermediate black holes, and we've only seen a couple of these at the moment, but these live in at the heart of globular star clusters. So these black holes are between about 100 and 10,000 times the mass of the sun. And finally, we have the supermassive black holes. These exist at the center of galaxies, and these can be anything from a million to several billion times the mass of the sun, all squeezed down into a tiny point that we call a black hole. So we've seen all three examples of those black holes. Now, here's my artistic impression of a black hole. I can see you're impressed. If you can't quite spot the black hole, I'll pull up an arrow there to help you. And this is the problem with black holes. Because light cannot escape, we can't see them and we can't investigate black holes as much as we'd like. But everything we know about black holes, we know from gas and stars nearby to the black hole. So that's how we are beginning to understand what black holes are. Now, to look at, to find an invisible object, we use an invisible form of light to do that. So our eyes are blind to most kinds of light, but we can see only between red and blue light. But actually, there are a lot more different types of light. There's infrared light, ultraviolet, X-rays and gamma rays. All of types of light are invisible to our eyes, but we can actually build cameras to detect those forms of light. So we use all these different forms of light to build up a picture of what black holes are and what they're doing. Now, gas at different temperature gives off light to different wavelengths. So you can see on this ridiculous thermometer, objects at our temperature, around about 30 degrees Celsius, we're not hot enough to give off visible light. We give off infrared light instead. When you look at stars in the night sky, if you see a red star, that will be maybe only 3,000 or 4,000 degrees Celsius, whereas a blue star will be much hotter, about 40,000 degrees. If you have really hot gas in the universe, maybe 1,000,000 degrees, then that will be giving off X-rays. So we use all these different types of light to see gas at different temperatures to build up a picture of what's happening. I use Celsius there, but scientists tend to use Kelvin instead. The only difference being that with the Celsius scale, we begin at -273.15 degrees, whereas with Kelvin, we start at zero. So Kelvin is kind of a more scientific measure of temperature we use. Now, as gas falls in towards the black hole, it gets superheated to 1,000,000 degrees and gives off X-rays. So this is one of the key methods we use to find black holes. This is XMM-Newton. This is a European space telescope. The cameras on board were built in the UK and in Germany. And my previous job was looking after these cameras and calibrating the cameras on board XMM. But this is a wonderful tool for finding black holes by looking for the X-rays being emitted by hot gas falling into them. Now, many years ago, I was involved in a project called the XID project, the X-ray identification project. Now, this is an image taken from XMM. And when you point XMM at a specific target, not only do you see what we want to look at, but we also see lots of objects around the outskirts. But what are those objects? Well, the project wanted to understand what all these objects are giving off X-rays and answer questions like how many binary stars are giving off X-rays, how many X-ray sources are black holes in distant galaxies, to kind of get a feel for the hot universe. So this is an observation, actually one of my observations with XMM, of the star LS Pegasi. LS Peg is a binary star system where they have a star, a bit like the Sun, and another star, which is a white dwarf. They're orbiting around each other, and the white dwarf is dragging gas away from its companion towards it. And yeah, that's my research area. So I was interested in LS Peg, but as you can see, there are lots of other objects giving off X-rays in the background, and the question is, what are those objects? Well, unfortunately, in that image, they are too faint for us to actually understand what those objects are just by looking at X-rays alone. So we need to do follow-up observations to understand exactly what those objects are. So to do that, we went to the Canary Islands, and we went to the island of La Palma, and at the summit of the volcano, of the dormant volcano in La Palma, is the Nordic Optical Telescope. And we use that telescope to do spectroscopy. Truth to say, the Nordic is probably my favourite telescope I've ever used, favourite observatory. Because usually, when you're at an observatory, you point the telescope in a different direction, and then you just move the dome so that the telescope lines up with the gap in the dome. Not with the Nordic. When the telescope turns around with the Nordic, the entire building with you inside it rotates as well. So it's kind of strange typing in a command to go to a new target, and then suddenly everything starts vibrating slightly as the entire telescope and observatory with you inside it rotates to another position to look at another object. That's strange for a few reasons. You can see the steps on the side. Every time you leave the building, the steps are in a slightly different location. And also that makes plumbing very difficult. So the kitchen is actually in another building about 50 meters away. If you want to know more about the Nordic, take a look at this deep sky video, which is a tour of inside the Nordic Optical Telescope. But anyway, yes, we were using Nordic to do spectroscopy. Let me just give you a brief introduction to what spectroscopy is. So this is the view from my house, and you can see there's lots of inefficient streetlights. These streetlights are shining into my house rather than shining onto the road. But notice the colour of the streetlights. The different colours are telling us that they are made up of different gases inside them. And sodium gas glows yellow. So the old-fashioned streetlights like this one from the 1960s contain sodium gas. And they put an electrical current through sodium gas and it glows yellow. So whenever you see that yellow glow, you know that you're looking at sodium gas. In fact, if not just pure yellow, it's yellow and a bit of green, and there are a few other shades as well, but yellow and green are the main two colours that comes from sodium gas. So by looking at the colours from the stars, looking at the rainbow, looking at their spectra, not only can we see what gases are in the object we are looking at, but we can also see how they are moving, because if those things are moving slightly towards us, then they get slightly bluer. And if an object is moving away from us, then the colours change to be slightly redder. So we can actually see gas is moving as well as what type of gas it is. So when we looked with the Nordic telescope at these objects giving off X-rays, we discovered some of these objects were not only redshifted or blueshifted, but both. In the, you know, you could see a broad range of colours where you expect just a narrow range. So how can something be both moving towards you and away from you at the same time? Well, if you ever see this pattern, that's a clear sign that something's going around in circles. And that's how something can be blue shifted and red shifted at the same time. And here's an artistic impression. Here is another binary star system. On the right hand side, you've got a massive star. And on the left hand side, you've got a black hole. So there used to be a star here, but it must have been a bit more massive than its companion. So it evolved a bit quicker and it turned into a black hole quicker than its partner. But now this star is a black hole. The gravity from the black hole is dragging the mass in, dragging in the gas from its companion. And as you can see, it's forming a disk. We call it an accretion disk. And gas is going around in a circle before eventually it falls into the black hole. You can see that some gas actually misses the black hole and ends up being tangled in a magnetic field and being squashed out of the north and south poles. But most gas are going around in a circle, and so the gas moving towards us is being blue shifted, and the gas moving away from us is being red shifted. And we see that very broad collection of colours as I showed before. We see lots of these binary systems. Here's another one, the first one seen, Cygnus X1. This was the first black hole discovered back in the 1960s. And then again, we've got a pair of stars, and one was a little bit more massive, so it evolved into becoming a black hole just a bit quicker than its companion. Cygnus X1 is about 6,000 light years away. So we saw some of, we discovered some of those objects with the XID project, but we also discovered these interesting objects called active galactic nuclei. So when we were observing with the Nordic Telescope, led by Peter Wheatley, we found these AGN, these active galactic nuclei. What's an AGN? Well, the clue's kind of in the name, in that they are the nuclei, the centre of a galaxy that's incredibly active. The centre of these galaxies can be as bright as the rest of the entire galaxy combined. And if you think of these galaxies, they're containing a few hundred thousand million stars, and at the heart, there is enough energy as the rest of the galaxy combined. So what can possibly create something that's so bright at the centre of these galaxies? Well, years of research has indicated that our best explanation is that there is a black hole that's feeding, and gas is falling into a black hole at the centre of these active galaxies. And that's what makes them so bright. As the gas falls towards the black hole, it glows very brightly in visible ultraviolet and eventually X-ray wavelengths as the gas falls into the black hole. And gas is falling in at the centre of these galaxies at a rate of between about a tenth to 10 times the mass of the Sun every single year. So here you can see another artistic impression. These things are so small and so far away, it's impossible to image them at the moment. So this is kind of our best guesses using clues, such as looking at the redshift and the blue shift. But you can see there are a massive amount of dust around this black hole. So in some cases, that dust actually blocks out our view of the black hole at the centre. And this ring of gas is in the form of a doughnut or torus. So you've got a big doughnut of cool gas, and that gas is slowly falling towards the black hole and getting incredibly bright before it eventually falls in towards the black hole at the centre of that galaxy. When that gas gets really close, an interesting thing called spaghettification happens. As I sit here, my feet feel more gravity than my head. Now, the difference here is tiny, so I can't actually feel the difference. But if you were to go close to a black hole, then your feet would feel so much more gravity than your head, you will be spaghettified, you will be stretched. And that's what happens whenever part of a dismembered star falls towards a black hole. It gets spaghettified and also superheated in the process, giving off lots of X-rays as it falls towards the black hole at the centre. Now, there's also a black hole at the centre of our own galaxy as well, the Milky Way. We call that Sagittarius A star. You can see being pointed out there by a laser beam from one of the telescopes in Hawaii. These laser beams are used to see how the atmosphere is shimmering and compensate for that. Now, when we look at the centre of our galaxy, we can actually see the stars moving around. And although we can't see a black hole itself, by looking at how quickly these stars are moving, we can calculate how much material must be at the centre. And if you do that calculation, it's around about 4 million times the mass of the Sun at the center of our galaxy. So there's one clue. Another clue is using XMM, and we pointed XMM-Newton at the center of our galaxy for about 8 hours. And then for 20 minutes, it suddenly brightened there. We think that that brightening was caused by part of a dismembered star, a little bit of gas, falling into the black hole at the center of our galaxy. And as it did so, it got heated up to 1,000,000 degrees, giving off X-rays before falling into the black hole. I should say the main difference between a active galactic nuclei and our galaxy, which is a normal galaxy, is the amount of gas that's nearby to the black hole at the center of the galaxy. In our galaxy, in our city of stars, there's not much gas at the center of our galaxy, so the black hole isn't feeding. But in AGN, in these active galactic nuclei, there's a huge amount of gas just waiting to fall in. And that's why they look so bright compared to our relatively quiet galaxy. Now, over the last couple of decades, we've come to a conclusion that there must be supermassive black holes at the center of every single galaxy. And every single galaxy we look at with telescopes that are sensitive enough to see evidence for a black hole, we actually find it. So yeah, we think that they are black holes at the center of all galaxies. Well, a few years ago now, I went to use the James Clerk Maxwell Telescope, again another telescope in Hawaii, and that's a submillimeter telescope. So this telescope is sensitive to light just somewhere in between radio waves and infrared light. And so this telescope looks, as you can see, more like a radio telescope than a traditional optical telescope that you might be used to. Now, when astronomers go to use these facilities, we're not quite sure what we're doing. We know what we want to look at, but we might never have used this particular telescope before. And so they are dedicated telescope operators at all these facilities. And the telescope operators, they know the telescope inside out. And when I went to use the JCMT, the telescope operator on those nights with Callie, and she knows that telescope inside out. And on one point, on one night at 3 o'clock in the morning, I just remember her diving out of the control room into the telescope room, and I had no idea what was happening and followed her, and I asked her what's wrong, and a power supply had failed, but she was able to turn it off and on again quickly, reset the power supply, so we didn't lose any data that night and we could carry on observing. But a few years later, Kelly was also involved in this project to image a black hole for the first time. This image was taken last year and it involved 8 telescopes around the world working together. And this is a radio submillimeter image of the shadow of a black hole. This is evidence for the first time that black holes do actually swallow up light. This proves that hole in the middle is the evidence that light cannot escape from a black hole. And this is an image of gas around a black hole at the center of the galaxy M87. So a tremendous observation there. Involves so much work, 8 different observatories, and a fantastic result from last year. And Kelly made her part in collecting that image of a black hole for the first time. Not only do we detect, not only do we see black holes and their effects, but we can actually see black holes in the process of forming. And we call these gamma ray bursts. So a gamma ray burst is known as the biggest bang since the Big Bang. These are huge explosions that we see from the very distant corners of the universe. And these indicate that a black hole was formed somewhere in the universe. These can form by either having a couple of neutron stars merge to form a black hole, or a couple of black holes may merge to form an even bigger black hole. And that process is so violent that we see a burst of gamma rays. Remember, gamma rays are the most energetic form of light we know of, even more powerful than X-rays. In orbit, we have the Swift Space Telescope, and that detects a gamma ray burst about once every 3 days, something like that, maybe two or three times a week. Although, having said that, this last week, Swift have seen 6 gamma ray bursts go off in the last week, so they've had a busy week this week. But you can see the latest bursts at that website. And if you want to know more about what the astronomers do, there's a nice video as well, the link is there, that follows a couple of friends of mine as they go around their day-to-day work using the Swift Space Telescope. The interesting thing is when Swift detects a gamma ray burst, it automatically sends a text message to astronomers on the ground, and then they can follow the observation using other telescopes around the world. But yeah, if you want to know more about that, watch that video as it follows Phil and Rana and their quest for finding another gamma ray burst. And yes, there's another way to do astronomy that's only turned up over the last 5 years. This is gravitational wave astronomy. Now, when two dense objects, like two neutron stars or two black holes merge, they bend space and send a ripple through the universe. It's a bit like dropping a stone into a pond and you can see the ripples going through water. When two dense objects merge together, ripples can go through space across the universe. And over the last few years, we've been able to detect these gravitational waves. We have two detectors, one in the US called LIGO and another one in Europe called Virgo, and they can detect the tiny bit of movement caused when a gravitational wave passes through the Earth, just 10 to the minus 19th of a meter. So that's less than a millionth of a meter. They can actually detect that change. So yeah, this is a new way to actually see black holes formed. And just last week, they saw an intermediate mass black hole form for the first time. As you can see from this graphic, two black holes merged, one 85 times more massive than the Sun, another 66 times more massive than the Sun, and they merged to form a black hole 142 times the mass of the Sun. And that's one of these intermediate mass black holes that we've not seen much evidence for, but this is a remarkable detection. Another 8 solar masses worth of energy was just drifted away into the universe, which enabled us to actually see this happen. So yeah, and just last week we saw two black holes merge for the first time. Now, I'd like to end by saying not to worry. Black holes are not dangerous and they're nothing to worry about, mainly because they're so impossibly distant away. We could never go and have a close look at a black hole. The distances are vast. Now, if you were to be squashed like in this cartoon, or stretched or spaghettified like in this cartoon, you would need to get very close to a black hole. If we had a black hole that was 5 times more massive than the Sun, you would have to be just 3,000 kilometers away to get stretched. So that's like half the distance to America, or the width of Europe. So yeah, that's impossibly close to a black hole. Even if you had a much bigger black hole, like the black hole at the center of our galaxy, the Milky Way, that black hole is 4 million times the mass of the Sun, But you'd still have to get really close, just 300,000 kilometers away, before you feel the effects of spaghettification. Now that's even closer than the moon. So here are some comparisons. The moon is 380,000 kilometers away. The sun is 150 million kilometers away. The next nearest star is 40 million million kilometers away. The nearest black hole we know of is called Curie-Tau, and that's some, let me get this right, 10,000 million million kilometers away. So black holes are so distant, even the closest stellar mass black holes are so distant that they have nothing for us to worry about at all whatsoever. So I hope you enjoy my talk, Black Holes and the Hot Spaghettification of Cool Doughnuts. Just let me finish by justifying my title again. We took a look at black holes and we saw that they come in small, medium or large varieties. When gas gets close to a black hole, it's distorted due to gravity and it's spaghettified. And it also gets superheated to a million degrees, giving off X-rays. So it's really hot spaghettification in action. And in these active galactic nuclei, those black holes can be fed by a huge doughnut of gas to supplying the black hole with gas and energy. And they are incredibly bright objects. We see them all over the universe by using X-ray telescopes such as XMM-Newton. Well, I'll finish there and I hope you enjoyed my talk.
Well, we hope you enjoyed this video. Once again, I've got to ask, if you did enjoy it, please give the video a like and subscribe to our channel to see our future updates. If you're interested in the future talks we've got coming up, do visit our website at bit.ly/Sussex Universe. And remember, if you're watching live, the live Q&A starts now at the Zoom link in the description down below.